What's up nerds, Heartless here. And in today's video I'll be doing my best to determine the difficulty of the Deathknight wing for both casuals and semi-hardcore guilds. So without further ado, let's begin. The first boss we'll encounter in the Deathknight wing is going to be Instructor Resuvius. Most of you will recognize his voice, as this is what Skarm, the YouTuber, is using for his intro.
The time for practice is over! Show me what you've learned!
Resuvius comes with 4 adds, and has only 2 abilities. Disrupting Shout, which is a large AoE ability that will drain mana from anyone it hits and deal twice as much as damage. This ability is capped at 4000 mana drained and therefore will deal up to 8000 damage total. This ability will also be used once every 25 seconds and can be line of sighted. His second ability is Unbalancing Strike, which is similar to the one used by Vecnilash, except it hits a lot harder, about 30,000 on a tank. He will use this ability every 6 seconds. Resuvius also has 2 million hit points, which is the equivalent of 2 flame gores. Not a lot of hit points, so using 10,000 raid DPS as our baseline, this fight won't last very long, only 3.3 minutes. Just looking at Resuvius's ability, this fight doesn't seem too hard, except of course for Unbalancing Strike. This mechanic alone changes everything and really makes this fight what it is. Since tanks can't tank Resuvius outside of Shieldwall, we'll need to use the adds, or understudies as they are called, to tank the boss by mind controlling them. The understudies have 2 abilities, Shieldwall and Taunt. Once mind control breaks, the understudies will receive a 45 seconds debuff, rendering them immune to mind control for the duration. The trick here is to mind control an understudy, taunt Resuvius and tank him while Shieldwall is up. Once Shieldwall fades, simply replace the understudy with one that has its cooldowns ready. The fight on its surface isn't very complicated, however it is prone to many mistakes, such as adds rotation, handling mind control breaking, which will happen to pretty much everyone, and of course positioning, which is very delicate, since mana users should never get hit by Disrupting Shout. All of those combines make the fight much harder than it seems to be. So, math time. Or is it? Normally this would be the part where I'd use some math to determine the expected base difficulty of the fight, except there isn't much to calculate here. You see, DPS isn't an issue, nor is tanking or healing, since there's almost none of. The difficulty of the fight lies in the mechanics themselves, so if a guild can execute them correctly, then pretty much anyone can down Resuvius. Unfortunately, mechanics are a bit subjective to judge, so all in all, I'd rate this fight as a 4 out of 10 in terms of difficulty for semi-hardcore guilds. Because most of its difficulty lies in practice, and once guilds get more practice in, the odds of wiping will reduce substantially. For casuals, this fight is a 6 out of 10, mostly due to lower DPS, which will require more understudies to be swapped, and the swapping here is the most fragile point in the fight, and where things can and will fail. Next boss is Gothic the Harvester. Gothic is a fight that is very similar to Razogor. It's a 2-phase fight, with phase 1 being the adds phase and phase 2 is a simple tank and spank where you just DPS Gothic down. Gothic has only 400k HP and will cast Harvest Soul debuff on the whole raid once every 20 seconds, reducing everyone's stats by 10% and stacking. He will also swap rooms every 20 seconds, starting on the living side until 20%, at which point the gates between the two rooms will open and everyone in the raid will be able to DPS Gothic down. But the Gothic fight was never about phase 2 anyway, just like with Razogor. This fight is all about managing the adds in phase 1. The adds and the room can be divided into two, the living side and the dead side. The living adds will spawn first and once killed will spawn after a few seconds on the dead side. There are 3 types of adds, 7 in total if you include their dead version. Unrelenting Rider, Unrelenting Deathknight, and Unrelenting Trainee. When killed, they transform into their spectral version, with the Unrelenting Rider splitting into two different spectral, Spectral Rider and a Spectral Horse. The Trainee is the first ad you'll see and has very little health, only 4,578. It has two abilities, a 3-second stun and a dot. They can be CC'd. The next ad is the Deathknight. It will charge a random player and stun them for 3 seconds. They will also cast a Whirlwind periodically that will apply a debuff to everyone it hits, causing the Rider to hit them with Shadow Bolts. The Deathknights have 20,500 hit points and can be CC'd. Last is the Rider. It will hit everyone around them for 450 damage every 2 seconds and will cast Shadow Bolts on the marked players. It has 25,900 HP. On the dead side, you'll see the Spectral Trainee. They will spam Arcane Explosion that hit for 522 arcane damage and have 5030 HP. They can be CC'd. There's also the Spectral Deathknight, who has 16,500 HP and will cleave Whirlwind, Sunder Armor, and Mana Burn. It can also be CC'd. Last, we have the Spectral Rider and Horse, who spawn once a Rider is killed on the living side. The Rider uses Unholy Aura, similar to the living side spell, which does 450 shadow damage every 2 seconds to everyone around it. It will also cast Life Drain, which is interruptible. It has 13,500 HP. The Horse will cast an AoE slow that reduces movement speed by 60%. It has 30,000 HP. In total, there will be 11 waves of 3 trainees, 7 waves of 2 Deathknights, and 4 waves of one Rider. The idea in phase 2 will be to kill as many mobs on the living side while CCing some as to not overwhelm the dead side. So, math time. I'll start with phase 2 because it's quick and easy. Gothic has 400k HP, 320k of which the raid will do split DPS on him because the gates are closed. We'll assume here equal DPS on either side, which will be 5000 DPS. Again, I'm gonna be using the 10,000 DPS raid total that I've been using so far. So 320,000 HP and 5,000 DPS will give us a total of 64 seconds, plus the remaining 80k HP with 10k DPS, and we have a total kill time of 72 seconds. I'll assume no walk time between sides because I'm lazy. The debuff is cast every 20 seconds, and the raid receives 1 the moment Gothic lands, meaning the most casual of guilds will only see 4 debuffs. Semi-hardcore guilds and above will probably never even see the third debuff. Point is, phase 2 is face roll, not much more to say. And yes, I know you will do less DPS as the fight goes on because base stats are gonna be reduced, but it's really not that relevant. Phase 1, however, is a lot trickier to math, since you can't assume equal DPS on both sides and do the math as is. There's also the fact that the wave's difficulty ramps up, so we can't really average everything either. Instead, what I did that made most sense to me was to divide the phase into 10 sections, basically mini phases, where each mini phase starts when trainees spawn. In the image, you can see that the DPS requirement to clear all the adds and move onward safely, i.e. have all the adds dead before the next mini phase starts, ramps up, though not in a linear way. Before the 1 minute and 40 seconds mark, there will be a time to recover for a bit. However, after that, things will ramp up quickly, and this is going to be the hardest part of the encounter, for casual guilds anyway. For semi-hardcores, the DPS requirement is essentially non-existent here, making the entire encounter trivial. Similar to Razorgore, with more DPS, the less likely it is that you'll get overrun, and with sufficient DPS, there is zero chance you'll wipe. While you might think that even if you assume equal DPS on both sides, that the DPS for casual guild is well within the limits we set ourselves, i.e. 5000 on each side, the truth is, it won't be this black and white. Remember, on the dead side, melee will also have travel time, rogues will need to walk to their targets, and warriors will not always have intercept available. That travel time will make up for a lot of lost DPS, so much so that casual guilds will actually struggle at the later half of this encounter. While CC on the living side can help a lot, it's again something that's impossible to calculate as it comes down to the raid's composition and personal skills, not something that can easily be measured. But still, because I was bored, I decided to break down the required DPS between the waves that is needed before the next wave spawns, or to prevent overwhelming. It's a bit hard to read, but you can see that from the 1 minute and 40 seconds mark, things really do ramp up. Keep in mind though, that after the last wave, the living side at least, will have about 40 seconds before Gothic comes down, which should give a lot of breathing room for guilds who will manage to survive to that part. Overall, this encounter, yet again, is gonna be trivial for semi-hardcore guilds and above, making it a 2 out of 10. Whilst for casual guilds, I'd rate this encounter a 7 out of 10, mostly due to the fact that even with some form of CC, things can escalate really quickly if tactics aren't executed perfectly, and even then, there might just not be enough DPS. Last encounter in the wing is probably the most iconic one in all of Nax, the Four Horsemen. The Four Horsemen encounter consists of, well, four horsemen, four mini-bosses that the raid must defeat in order to clear the wing. The Four Horsemen are High Lord Mograine. He has 533,000 HP and casts Righteous Fire on the tank, which does 2.2k damage on impact and an additional 600 damage per second for 8 seconds. Thane Cortez has 599k HP and will cast Meteor once every 12 seconds that will hit a random player within 20 yards for 14k fire damage, split among everyone that's within 8 yards of the target. Sir Ziliak has 500k HP and will cast Holy Wrath once every 12 seconds. This ability will target a random player within 35 yards of the boss and will hit them for an average of 550 holy damage. It will also chain to nearby players within 5 yards, with each chain doubling its damage. And last is Lady Blaumax. She has 499k HP and she will summon a void zone under the feet of a random player within 45 yards of her. Players standing in the void zone will take 4000 shadow damage per tick. The void zone has a very small radius and will persist for 90 seconds. So those are all the unique abilities of the horsemen. Apart from those, they all share three other abilities. At 50% and 20%, they will use shield wall, which reduces their damage taken by 75% for 20 seconds. They will also cast a unique mark on all players within 65 yards that will last for 75 seconds. This mark is similar to the one Pharma does, it stacks, and with each subsequent mark, it will deal more and more damage. They will cast it once every 13 seconds. Yes, 13 seconds, not 12 like WoW Wiki states. Well, at least according to Warcraftlogs data from the PTR. First mark does 250 damage, the second will deal 1000, then 3000, 5000, 6000, etc. The last shared ability is that once killed, a ghost version of themselves will spawn at the kill location. That ghost will not move, does not need to be tanked, and will not cast any ability except for the mark. So, let's start with the basics, if you can call it that, cause the math here is gonna be a bit more complicated compared to the other stuff I've done so far. Before I begin, I'll assume players can soak 4 marks. On the 5th, they die. So here goes. After running some numbers, raids with 10,000 DPS will need to use 4 groups rotating in order to defeat Cortez and Mograine, which is the first pair we'll tackle. Cortez will require the raid to soak the meteor at all times, else the tank dies. Assuming equal split of the DPS, each group will do 2500 DPS. Exit Q will be our 4th mark, which happens every 52 seconds except for on pull, where it's 59 seconds. So, 2500 DPS times 59 seconds gives us a total of 147,500 damage done, leaving Cortez with 452,500 HP when group 1 leaves and group 2 goes in. Group 2 will do 130,000 damage before they need to exit, leaving Cortez with 322,500 HP. Group 3 enters, 9 seconds into their turn, they will force the 50% shield wall. 43 seconds remaining, 20 of which are due during Shield Wall, so 12,500 damage plus the 57,500 remaining gives us Cortez with 252,500 HP left when Group 3 needs to leave. Group 4 enters, and with 2500 DPS, they will deal 130,000 damage, bringing Cortez down to 122,500 HP. Group 1 enters again, and within 1 second, they will force the 20% shield wall, during which they'll do 12,500 damage. After 20 seconds, shield wall will expire, and Group 1 will have 31 seconds to DPS Cortez, leaving him with 30,000 HP. The remaining HP can be dealt with by Group 2, which will need 12 seconds. Overall, it took our heroes 4.5 minutes to defeat Cortez. During those 4.5 minutes, the raid should also be able to down Mulgrane, since he has less HP than Cortez, and the 4 group rotation will be between Cortez, Mulgrane, and the safe spot. The next half of the fight is versus Ziliex and Blaumex. They each have 500k HP and will require similar rotation. For the most part, the raid can address them in a similar fashion to how they did Mulgrane and Cortez, except the raid, or the melee specifically, will need to be more conscious about positioning. For the sake of simplicity, if that's even possible to say at this point, I'll assume that Ziliex and Blaumax, DPS-wise, will be similar to Mulgrane Cortez, which means that they will require an additional 3 minutes on average to be killed. Overall, this fight will last about 6.5 to 7 minutes for casual guild, assuming, of course, zero deaths. Except it's going to be longer. With our 4 group rotation, this fight requires the usage of 8 tanks, meaning that 4 DPS warriors will be out of the equation when it comes to DPS, which is quite significant. On top of that, the reality is, people are going to die here, especially in casual guilds, mostly due to the sheer amount of coordination this fight requires. I can't really math it, obviously, but I'd venture to guess that this fight will take our casual guilds about 9 to 10 minutes, which is very long, the longest fight we've seen so far. 9 to 10 minutes is massive and will require healers to be on top of their game mana-wise. In a sense, this fight is actually an attrition fight. Semi-hardcore guilds, and specifically speedrunning guilds, will probably be able to cleave the horsemen on pool, at least for some limited time. But even then, coordination will be required and the fight will not be as trivial. For semi-hardcore guilds, I would say this fight is going to be an 8 out of 10. For casual, it's a 10 out of 10 in difficulty. For my prediction, I expect to see a lot of guilds get stuck on this fight for at least a few weeks. And this is it for the Deathknight Wing. 3 bosses, 2 of which are going to be pretty easy for semi-hardcore guilds, whereas for casuals, well, they might find all of them fairly hard, with horsemen being by far the hardest to tackle.